In this lesson, we will learn the difference between static and kinetic friction, and more importantly, when to use which. So let us say we have a mass M sitting on a table, and we push this mass with a certain force F equal to 10 newtons. And what you find is that the mass does not move. And why it doesn't move? Is because there's a force of friction equal in magnitude opposing the force you are putting on the mass. So this becomes 10 Newton. Now, before we go ahead, let us spend a quick minute on what exactly happens when an object slides on a surface and establish the two reasons why friction happens. So if you take a regular surface, even if it is well polished, and see it under a microscope, this is what you would see. It is far from being flat. So what happens is, when two such surfaces are placed together, only the high points like these come in contact. And then many atoms of one surface contact many atoms of the other surface, and the surfaces kind of cold weld together, instantly forming a single piece of metal. And these welds are what produce static friction. So when an applied force attempts to slide the surfaces relative to each other, and if the applied force is great enough to pull one surface across the other, there is first a tearing of welds, and then a continuous reforming and tearing of welds as motion occurs. And if the two surfaces are pressed together harder, many more points cold weld, and that is the reason we say that the greater the normal force, more the friction. So this is reason number one for occurrence of friction. Now the second reason is more straightforward, which is due to interlocking of these peaks and valleys you see on the surfaces in contact. And rough surfaces have larger number of such irregularities, and therefore the surface offers more friction as compared to smooth surfaces. Okay, moving forward, now let us say you increase this force to 11 newtons and you find the box is still not moving. And why is it not moving? Because now the force of friction has also increased to 11 newtons to oppose the force you are putting on the box. Now, let's say you decide to take the force up to 12 newtons and the box still does not move. And you know why? Because the force of friction has also increased to 12 newtons. And if you keep increasing the force of friction would also increase in the same magnitude. But then there would be a time when the box would just about start moving. So let's say the force required to just about move the box is 18 newtons. Or in other words, 18 newton is a force where any decimal increase in the force would make the block move. So now the force of friction would also be 18 newtons. So if you now put a force of, let us say, 18.0001 newtons, the box will start moving because the force of friction is not able to keep up and the box kind of breaks loose and starts moving. So you see, this is the maximum the force of friction could go before the box could free itself. And we call this maximum force. In a more formal way, as a maximum static force of friction. And why static? Because the word static means stationary. But then you see, these forces are also values of static force of friction. But this magnitude is special because this is maximum possible static force of friction, which equals mu static into normal reaction. Now, this coefficient mu static, or mu s, is a dimensionless number and is determined experimentally. That is, we do actual experiments in a lab and assign values to various combination of surfaces, and these values depend on properties of both the body and the surface. Hence, they are usually referred to as between, like the value of mu static between aluminium on steel is 0.61, or between copper on glass is 0.68, or between rock climbing shoes and rock is as much as 1.2. Now, once a box starts moving, the force of friction reduces. And therefore, we now use a different coefficient of friction to calculate the friction acting on the box. And thankfully, this friction remains more or less constant and is written as mu k into the normal reaction, where mu k is the kinetic coefficient of friction. And we call it kinetic because kinetic pertains to movement. And since this force is less than this force, mu k is always less than mu s. So now you know the reason as to why, if you try to push a table, the initial force required to push is more than the force required to keep it moving. Okay, now let us say you wish to find mu s between surface 1, that is iron, and this wooden box experimentally. So what we do is that we take the box and put it on an inclined plane made of iron. And then you slowly increase the incline and you raise the angle to a point where the box just about starts sliding down. So let's say that at this point, the angle is alpha. Then the forces acting on the box are 1 mg acting in the downward direction. And if you resolve mg into its components, what you'll find is you'll get one force in this direction and another force would be in this direction. And you know that if this is angle alpha, this would also be alpha. In which case, this force would be mg cos alpha and this force would be mg sin alpha. Now, what you would also know intuitively is that since the box is not moving, there is a force of friction which is stopping its motion, and it has to act in the opposite direction. So let's go ahead and denote that force as F max, which is equal to mu s into n. So now if we apply Newton's second law of motion along this axis, and keeping in mind that this is the sine notation, we get on the left hand side plus mg sine alpha minus mu s into n, and this should equal mass into acceleration. But we know that there is no acceleration because the object is stationary or is just about to move. So this becomes zero. And what we get is mu s into n is equal to mg sine alpha. Now, if you write f is equal to ma for this axis, what you get is n minus mg cos alpha is equal to ma, where ma again becomes zero since there is no acceleration in this direction as well, or n is equal to mg cos alpha. And if we use this value of n in this equation, what we get is mu s into mg into cos alpha is equal to mg sin alpha. And you can see mg cancels on both sides, and what we get is mu s, or the static coefficient of friction, is equal to tan alpha. So what this equation means is that we can say that the static coefficient of friction between two surfaces, rather two specified surfaces, is the tan of the angle at which the object just about starts moving. Now, one interesting thing you would have seen here is that the coefficient of static friction is independent of the mass. So it's dependent on the nature of the two surfaces only. So if you find this topic slippery, then your compass to navigate out of the slippery territory is this playlist. And if you like the lesson, please do give a thumbs up. That would be nice. And feel free to ask any questions in the comments below.